central San Joaquin Valley tomorrow. Some fog in the morning, then sunny with highs from 72 to 78 degrees. That's it for the news tonight on this Friday, November 14th. Thanks for joining us. Thanks to Andrea Keys, who helped to write this newscast. Today's recorded portions were produced by Rose Katavshi. She's also at the controls. With Andrea Lewis, I'm Mark Miracle. Good evening.
This is KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. Up next, Full Circle. Stay with us.
Full Circle, yes, we rotate 360 degrees. Ha ha, 360 degrees. Ha ha, 360 degrees. Ha ha.
Hello and welcome to Full Circle. Tonight we bring you sounds from honoring the past, celebrating the future. The 2008 Dia de los Muertos Festival that took place in East Oakland.
And we are also going to highlight the Access Dance Company's 20th anniversary season. We are your hosts, Imogene and Angela. Keep it locked.
Se me acabe la vida frente a una copa de vino y que te diga el destino que vas a vivir sin mí. Que se me cierren los ojos que fueron tu gran cariño. Que se sienta en tu pecho de veras que ya me fui. Que se me acabe la vida y que tú la sigas viviendo. A ver si al cabo del tiempo tus labios se siguen riendo. A ver si saben poner el mundo a tus pies como yo lo hacía. A ver si saben decir las cosas de amor que yo te decía. A ver si saben, chiquitita, que se me acabe la vida y que tú la sigas viviendo. A ver si al cabo del tiempo tus labios se siguen riendo. A ver si saben poner el mundo a tus pies como yo lo hacía. A ver.
And that was Que se me acabe la vida by Mariachi Los Camperos de Natigano. And we are your hosts, Imogene and Angela. Tonight we're going to be talking to you about the Dia de los Muertos Festival that just took place here in Oakland in the Fruitvale last week. So the changing of the seasons from fall to winter, although today definitely felt like summertime to me, but the changing of these seasons is definitely an opportunity for introspection and reflection. And it is during this time that many cultures honor their loved ones who have passed on. Dia de los Muertos, or Day of the Dead, is celebrated in Mexico and in the United States on November 1st and 2nd. The Mexican people believe the gates of heaven are opened at midnight on October 31st, and that for 24 hours, angelitos, the spirits of deceased children, are allowed to rejoin their families. The modern celebration involves making offerings of food, flowers, and other items at an altar in honor of the deceased.
And these altars are often adorned with yellow and orange marigolds, the traditional pre-Columbian flower of the dead. In addition to these flowers, altars are decorated with fruit, pan de muerto, pictures of saints, calaveras, chocolate, photographs of the dead, and candles. In Mexico, people traditionally spend the night in the graveyard by their family member's tomb, cleaning it and decorating it. And the cemetery itself becomes a site of great celebrations.
Let's hear some voices from the Dia de los Muertos event in the Fruitvale telling us why they think it is important to honor those who have passed.
Dia de los Muertos, because in the U.S. it feels like death is something that we should be scared of, which we shouldn't be. It's actually, that's why we do Dia de los Muertos, to celebrate the life of our people that have been lost, but they're not really dead. You know, their spirits are still here and they're still around us, so that's why I think it's important to celebrate Dia de los Muertos, because in the U.S. you really don't see that, and you see that death is something to be scared of and afraid of, and you really shouldn't be. When you die is when you truly start living.
How do you feel about celebrating
Dia de los Muertos? Well, I don't know. I like it a lot because it just reminds us of our culture, and it also just reminds us of not just celebrating, but death itself and people that are passed, you know? Yeah. And it reminds me of my nephew who, like, passed away last year. And it's just like, it's not a mourning, it's a celebration. And I like that about, you know, Day of the Dead. It's not just something sad, it's something happy. So it's another way of looking at death.
Basically honoring, like, the people that has died, like, people, not just people that we know, but people that died on the borders, people that died on the war, and basically just people that died for, like, a lot of different reasons, you know. We could know them, we don't have to know them, it doesn't matter, but we're basically just honoring just people that died.
How do you feel about celebrating Dia de los Muertos?
It feels good to honor your loved ones that already passed away. It's a good day to remember them. Just remembering them how they were, it's nice always to remember, because at times you forget. It's always a day to remember.
I actually like it because it teaches the children that you don't necessarily have to be sad when someone passes away. You can actually be happy for them, especially if it was someone who was suffering. They're no longer suffering. So with our program, all the kids did the work. And so the kids learned a little bit about the parents or family members who have passed on, to look at it in a positive way and not such a negative way.
Welcome back to Full Circle. I really like what they were saying in that last piece about celebrating people's lives, and I agree that here in the United States, a lot of times we are afraid of death and very distant, and that it's so important to also honor the lives of those who passed on and have that balance.
Word. And First Voice had the opportunity to attend the Dia de los Muertos event in Fruitvale on October 26th. We collaborated with the multimedia training program Raising Our Voices. Their program director is Eloise Rose Lee from Media Alliance. Raising Our Voices trains people in multimedia skills at the Eastside Arts Alliance in Oakland. First Voice helped the Raising Our Voices participants to do their first interviews at the Unity Council's 14th annual Dia de los Muertos event, honoring the past, celebrating the future.
Coming up next, we hear from Marty Zulalis, speaking with Sag Nicte Salazar from the organization WashTech. Sag Nicte is passionate about her community and fights for equal rights for immigrants. She attended the Dia de los Muertos event to honor the sacredness of life and death. Here, Nicte describes why the tradition of Dia de los Muertos is such an important ceremony.
This day is important for us for two reasons. As the tradition that we have, understanding that us as human beings, our human beings, pass this life, this body, and that we need to honor those who have passed, but also because a lot of our folks, you know, living in this world, are suffering and are dying way before their time. So this is a really special day for us.
So why do you think it's important to celebrate an event like this?
Well, to us, it's more than an event. This is a ceremony, and I think that it's really dope to be able to bring our traditions out into the community and be able to expose people who don't typically understand what it means for us, what our traditions mean, to be able to expose them to to that. So it's dope to bring it out into the streets of the Fruitvale, but for us it's more than, you know, a festival or, you know, an event. It's a ceremony. It's a celebration of life. So that's what we do, and it's dope to be able to bring it out here and also be able to have our young folks express their art through creating altars, and also just be able to bring the community together and make sure that everything's positive.
That's really cool how you, like, bring in your youth in. Could you, like, explain how does your organization and your youth connect to this event?
Well, our organization is WASHTEC, and we work out here in... We're based out here in Oakland, but we're young folks from Oakland, Berkeley, Richmond, and San Leandro mainly. And our young folks are about... what we do is teach tradition, protect tradition, and reteach tradition, but also one of the most important things is working for our community and bettering our community through doing organizing work. And part of that is coming out here and being able to teach tradition through creating altars and being a part of the community, but also just connecting with different folks who may not be exposed to the world of organizing or to the world of traditions that have been lost because we're forced to go through these education systems that, you know, only expose us to Halloween or, you know, to ideas of death being something evil or scary, you know. So just really being able to expose our folks to traditions. And also one of the main reasons that we come out here is because you see a lot of homies out here that use these days as days to come out and claim their turf. So just for us really being able to be out here and try to make sure that things are stay positive. Our folks do security at events, and, you know, for us it's about protecting land and life. So while we're out here, it's also about that, you know, chopping it up with homies, making sure that they're keeping it positive, and also trying to bring them into the organizing world, because those are folks fiending for something different, but there's no one out there reaching out to them.
That's really good how you give the point that our education system doesn't really show us about other cultures and how it's just only Halloween. And so I want to ask you, how has this event helped you better yourself and your culture?
I think that for us, traditions are what keep us balanced. Traditions are what help us be able to bring balance into this universe. So just really understanding all of that and being grounded. We fully believe that, you know, people without roots, you know, people without their history, without their traditions, is like a tree with no roots. So, you know, we see the change in our young folks going from banging in the streets to becoming danzantes, or just simply being able to have their head up high and be proud to be who they are, because, you know, they learn what greatness they come from, and they learn their role in this universe as creating balance, as, just helping and healing and bringing community together. So I think that's, like I was saying before, this day of Dia de los Muertos is more than just a day, but it's, you know, a longer tradition of us being able to bring balance into this universe and being able to connect to all our relations and everything around us and bring respect to that.
That's true. That's so true. So, like, the closing question, what makes you personally continue celebrating in the future?
So like I said again, this is a tradition that we've learned from our elders, and there's no way that once you understand what role you have in that, you can stop that. So, you know, for me, I have more of an obligation to not only celebrate myself and to have this as a daily practice, because, you know, this month is a month where the spirits, the world between the spirit world and our world is closer together. You know, the veil between our two worlds are closer, and they come in and visit us, but they're here throughout. You know, we understand our humans as vibrating energies, and they're here with us all the time. So we keep an altar in our homes, and we teach that to our young folks. And we also teach them that this is an important day and that they need to be a part of that, and protecting tradition most of all, because everything out there is trying to break tradition and trying to steal and destroy our tradition. So it's an important role that we play as Chicanas, you know. We call ourselves Chicanas with an X, folks that may not have that direct connection to our nation, but we know that the unknown is there for us to find, and we're searching for it, and
that's our role, to continue this and to protect it and, you know, keep it going. So that's why I do it. That's what's going to keep me going, and what's going to keep me teaching other folks to continue doing it.
I love how you explain everything. So I'd like to thank Signique Salazar for joining us today at this event, cultural celebration in Fruitvale. She could be reached at stoptheraidsnow@gmail.com. Let me spell that out for you. stoptheraidsnow@gmail.com. Recording live with your host, Marty Dulales. We got to fight the cause, fight for our people. And again, this is KPFA 94.1. Peace out.
They say in Oaxaca, you drink coffee with mezcal. They say in Oaxaca, you drink coffee with mezcal. Urban smoke are plenty to chase the wave of life. Urban smoke are plenty to chase the wave. I like to try the molly, that soledad is going to grind. Get the salt and the bread. You grind and you fry the chili. You boil the chocolate. Get cinnamon and banana. Get cloves and oregano. Get thyme and the blackest pepper. You grind it in Mexico.
Are listening to the voice of Lila Downs, La Cumbia de Mole. That song was making me hungry, hearing all those ingredients that you put in mole. You know, going back to the Dia de los Muertos altars, I went to the Oakland Museum the other day, and they're having a Dia de los Muertos exhibit, and there was one altar that really stood out to me. It was a Mexican woman whose husband was from China, and she combined all of these decorations, all of these, you know, beautiful pieces from both the Mexican culture and the Chinese culture in honor of his life. And it was, you know, really an amazing piece of artwork. And I definitely recommend people to go check out that exhibit, because it's going to be there for a while. And just thinking about how cultures all around the world celebrate life in different ways, honor death, and use altars for those purposes, is really beautiful.
Yeah, that's beautiful. And now we go to an interview with Rangita Giesler, who spoke with Marsha Murrington, Executive Vice President of the Unity Council, the organization that has organized El Dia de los Muertos celebration in the Fruitvale for the last 13 years.
I'm Rangita Giesler here in the Fruitvale District of East Oakland, and we're reporting live from the Dia de los Muertos Festival. And you are tuned to Full Circle. I have with me Marsha Murrington, who is the Executive Vice President of the Unity Council, and they have organized this festival for 13 years. Welcome, and thank you for coming on our show.
Thank you for being here and celebrating with us.
So this festival began 13 years ago. There are many artists here and a lot of people. It's a crowded event. Talk about the roots of when this festival began and why the Unity Council brought this festival to the Fruitvale District.
Well, in 1996, we started a Main Street program, and the festival was actually a kickoff of our commercial area and our initiative around really bringing people into the area and showing them that we were a very culturally diverse and vibrant commercial district. So it grew from about 1,000 people attending that first year to now over 100,000 people attend. And Congresswoman Barbara Lee actually put us in the Library of Congress about 6 years ago as one of the top festivals in her district.
Describe some of the artists who come here and the importance of having the local community come out and participate.
Well, it's not just bringing artists in, but it's also bringing artists that share their talent of making altars with the community. So prior to the festival, we actually have classes that take place so that people can participate and really learn about how to build an altar. And as you walk through the festival site, you can see the powerful altars that are located here. One in particular that is right in the Avenida de los Altars is put together with the two, there are multiple crosses, many crosses in there, and they represent the homicides in 2008 that took place in the city of Oakland. It's a very powerful statement when you see all of these people that were killed over the years. And it is to really honor them and their families. So every altar has a theme, and it is to remember the people that have passed and to honor them, and also to share this with the community.
And when many people think of loved ones passing, it's often a somber and sad conversation to have. However, the mood here isn't like that. It's very celebratory. Describe the spirit of this festival in Dia de los Muertos.
Well, actually, Dia de los Muertos is a joyful time because it's remembering people. And it's also, if you look at the altars, there are fond memories of like special foods that people liked or certain drinks that they really enjoyed. Pictures, flowers. So it becomes not just a time to remember in sorrow, but to remember the happiness that that person had while they were here. So it really is to celebrate life and the afterlife and death.
You are part of the Unity Council. You're the Executive Vice President, and we're speaking with Marcia Murrington here at Dia de los Muertos. The Unity Council's mission is to help families and individuals to build wealth and assets through sustainable economic developments and education, socially responsible profit sharing. Describe more of what the Unity Council does in the community.
We've been in the community for 44 years, and we actually take a multiple approach to really working with families in the community. So we have programs that range from early childhood development in Head Start and Early Head Start. We work with youth in after-school recreation programs to provide youth with better alternatives to after-school activities. We promote family literacy through a family literacy program. We actually have a large workforce development program, so we try to look at not just placing people in jobs, but placing in people in jobs with upward mobility. We have a large business assistance program that consists of all the businesses here in the commercial area and our public market, which is a business incubator that has 12 businesses that are just startup businesses. And we work with them to make sure that they're building their assets and their family assets. We have a large home ownership center that provides not only home ownership counseling, financial literacy, and also foreclosure counseling. So as you can see, we span a lot of areas. We have a large AmeriCorps program that engages youth from our community in positive activities. We also have a senior center and senior housing facilities. So we actually provide services from birth all the way till people age, and hopefully they age in place and are able to have a good quality of life.
That's Marsha Merrington, the Executive Vice President at the Unity Council, and she's speaking about the programs that the Unity Council offers. And I think that it's so important to get to the root of the social problems that create dysfunction in the communities, and it, to me, stems from the economics. So when you talk about the solutions around economic development and creating those sustainable businesses where families and local people are engaged in creating their own options so that they can survive, so that they have the tools to bring in income, I think it's so important. You personally are, as the Executive Vice President, how have you been impacted through the work that you're doing at the Unity Council?
That's a really, really hard question to answer. I think nonprofit work is probably so underrated and not understood. If you look around and really look at the people in the community, you really feel like you've made a difference. And there's really nothing that replaces that.
And where do you see the festival going from this year on into the next 10 years?
I'm hoping that we continue to have great engagement of artists and a lot of people come into the neighborhood, not just for the festival, but to come back and really experience the beauty of our community and all the great businesses and food and the wonderful, vibrant community that we have here. So not just on the day of the festival, but please come back.
Well, thank you so much for joining us, Marsha Merrington, Executive Vice President at the Unity Council. If you want to reach the Unity Council, you can check their website out at www.unitycouncil.org or give them a call at 510-535-6900. And thank you so much, Marsha, for joining us today.
Thank you.
It's a special event in Mexico, and it's becoming a strong day in the United States as well. We celebrate in different ways, especially we have dinners and meals for the dead ones. That's the whole celebration. We are supposed to bring whatever that the loved one that died used to eat. For example, if the loved one died, his favorite meal was a mole, they bring mole to his tomb. And his favorite drink, the water can be soda, whatever. The past one, the loved one who died, treat him. It's a treat. It's a day for the people who die, and it's treated today. Bring flowers and bring food.
Can you tell us how you celebrate Dia de los Muertos?
We just dance as a way to honor the people that passed away, our ancestors. So when we dance, we use the incense, and the incense just takes our prayers to heaven. And we feel that we are heard by the ones who pass away. So we spend the whole night dancing and praying and singing for the dead the whole night. And in the morning, we dance again for them.
Every year, we come down here and celebrate festivities. And I hang out with my family members that come here, too.
This is basically kind of new for me because I'm from Chile. Chile is a little different. The base is the same. You honor your people, you know, that pass away. But here, coming to the States and living among Latin Americans, mostly from Mexico and Central America, you know, you start developing this sense of one community, and the other one is just like that dead is not necessarily dead. It just means that it's a full circle that goes to life.
For us, Dia de los Muertos is a celebration to really, you know, like everybody, be able to remember those who have passed and our ancestors. And for myself, I have young folks and danza groups that we celebrate with in a big ceremony on November 1st and 2nd, where we're able to, one, you know, maintain our traditions alive, but also honor our dead in a really good way and make sure to be there with them on that day where their spirits are with us. And teaching the young folks what this day is about. I think that for a lot of people, the day's just this day is just one day, but you know, Day of the Dead is something that we have to maintain alive throughout the year. This is just one day of the year when all the spirits come back, but making sure that they understand the significance of the altar, the significance of, you know, the flowers, the candles, all the four elements, and make sure that that's a part of their life every day. For our group is called Washtek, and that's what we do, is relearn tradition and protect tradition and teach tradition to those who don't know it, because that's a part of creating balance in the universe. So, you know, for us, it's more than just this day.
By Quetzal, the song is Limones Agrias. Before that, we heard voices from the crowd at the Dia de los Muertos festival talking about the different aspects of the celebration. If you're just tuning in, we are playing interviews gathered at the Dia de los Muertos event in Fruitvale on October 26th. We collaborated with the multimedia training program Raising Our Voices, which is facilitated by Eloise Rose Lee out of Eastside Arts Alliance in Oakland.
Coming up next, Full Circle contributor Terry Bautista speaks with Consuelo Supalario and Norma Juarez, who shared an altar for their sons who died. And after that, we will hear Evangelina Lara, who speaks with Maria Ramos.
You're tuned into Full Circle on KPFA 94.1. Reporting live from El Dia de los Muertos in the Fruitvale district of East Oakland, surrounded by many altars made by local artists. I'm talking to Consuelo Supalario, a parent who has an altar dedicated to her son, Cesar, who was killed in a place called Crash Curve. Consuelo, I understand you've been here since 7 o'clock this morning.
Yes, I have. I was helping set up the altar for my son. I slowly went through all his things last night, and it just seemed like it was really hard to bring out all his memorabilia and everything that represented my son. We had to put everything out for the altar and set up this morning.
You also have a friend with you, Norma Juarez. Norma Juarez is another mother whose son is honored in the same altar. He's a victim of violence in the community. So Norma, can you tell us a little bit about the altar?
The September 1st, two morning, I received a call from my son, Roger, and he told me that Alan, my other son, was in chat.
Wow. It's really so hard. Yes.
Oh, which told me. But the doctor said, I'm sorry, lady. It was so many chances. Alan, his body, you know. He's dying. Oh, my God. You can imagine what I feel. I feel terrible. I thank you. That's a nightmare. Something good.
Can you tell us about what's in the altar?
I have my picture over there, and the Dia de los Muertos is a good opportunity to me to for telling to everybody about violence in the street and offline.
How are you able to use the altar today to feel better about your son? Does it make you feel better?
I feel my son is not alone with the. I think two guys is still with him, and I feel like they see us. You know, they today I think they see his mother over here, and they. And we are doing something for them.
You're tuned into Full Circle, KPFA 94.1. This is Terry Bautista talking to Consuelo Sapolario and Norma Juarez about their sons whose altar is in the Fruitvale El Dia de los Muertos Festival. Consuelo, your son passed away in...
December 19th.
Last year. 2007. So what does this event mean to you today, and putting up an altar for your son?
That my son's spirit still lives, and that he was a good young man, and he meant well, and he was doing good for the community. He wasn't a child who got in much trouble. I know the military wanted him, but I said my son has something else set up for him. He wanted to do something good for the community, and also with the group called Crece that he was involved with. He was a Puente student up at Merritt College, and he wanted to be a radiologist. He was to travel to El Salvador and help people with medical supplies and educational supplies that's still needed there in that country.
You're tuned in to Full Circle, KPFA 94.1. This is Terry Bautista talking to Consuelo Sapolario and Norma Juarez. Norma, the altar has helped you feel better about your son. So what do you think will happen in the future? What do you hope to happen in the future?
I don't want, you know, more people die in the same situation. You know, a lot of young guys and young kids, they lose their life in the streets in prison. If they don't have reason for lost their life. My son has a lot of dreams to get him through it. And somebody is coming to kill him. That's it's ridiculous, you know. But I think that my feeling is, and I want to tell you something. I think that Oakland City has to do something, you know. The people have to do something about the guys. Every day, it's more and more gangs. Member gangs and in the street, and that's because they don't have any places to go, spend a good time, work or something good for their life, you know. And even if the message is for everybody, parents too, they have to give more time to the kids, you know, because our son and his and her son and their girl die it is not because they are bad guys, they are really good guys.
So, in the case of Cesar, he wasn't killed from an act of violence, Consuelo, but where it happened, can you tell a little bit more about that?
In his case, the neighbors are getting together something to do something about a road that they feel that's not safe. They call it crash curve. It's a nickname that they call because there has been like over 5 deaths there on that road.
So in both situations, you want the city to do something about the situation.
Yes.
For safety.
Yes. For I don't want anybody else to suffer like I'm suffering right now.
Okay.
For my son.
Well, I'd like to thank Consuelo and Norma. Thank you very much. And Alicia, our interpreter. We're here at Dia de los Muertos. I'm Terry Bautista for Full Circle, KPFA 94.1.
Estoy aquí con Primera Voz en KPFA 94.1 FM. Estamos reportando en vivo desde el Día de los Muertos en el distrito Fruitvale, en el este de Oakland, evento que se realiza cada año. Hoy nos acompaña la señora María Ramos. Le agradezco que quiera compartir con nosotros hablando de sus tradiciones que todavía perduran y que cada día es más popular, ya que lo celebran día a día recordándolos, pero este 2 de noviembre ella nos va a compartir lo que para ella significa el Día de Muertos.
Para mí significa una cosa a la vez sagrada, a la vez triste, pues porque yo me encuentro en el motivo de que ya no tengo mis padres. Ahora pues quiero compartirlo con todos, que es un día que debemos compartirlo todos, porque es un día que todas las familias nos hace falta alguien de nuestra casa, alguien de nuestra familia, y pues quisiera compartirlo con todos.
Señora María Ramos, díganos o cuéntenos a la radio dónde nació, cuánto tiempo tiene viviendo aquí.
Bien, yo vengo de México, tengo 5 años que vine aquí al Oakland.
¿Qué cambios ha notado al participar en este evento en el área de la Fruitvale, señora María Ramos?
¿Los cambios que he notado yo para mí?
Sí.
Pues he notado que es mucha motivación para los jóvenes también hacer todos estos programas.
Bien, estamos escuchando a Full Circle con nuestra anfitrión 94.1 y estamos hablando de usando la primera voz en el Festival de Día de los Muertos en la Fruitvale, en el este de Oakland. Señora Mari, ¿ha notado usted un cambio desde que ha participado veniendo cada celebración del Día de los Muertos? Porque usted dice que tiene 5 años viviendo aquí. ¿Viene cada año a este lugar?
Sí, tengo 5 años que estoy participando. A mí me gusta participar para el Día de los Muertos, para el 5 de mayo, en todos los eventos que hay aquí por la Fruitvale, y me gusta que vengan mis hijos para que no olviden todas estas costumbres.
Señora Mari, ¿usted quisiera antes de terminar mencionar algo que a usted le preocupa al venir a este tipo de eventos? Porque sabemos de antemano que hay muchísima gente. Usted mencionó que le gusta venir con sus hijos. ¿Quiere agregar algo más antes de terminar esta entrevista?
Sí, les quisiera agregar pues que quiero que haya más cuidado aquí en estas funciones, porque yo tengo un hijo que él ya no le gusta participar en esto, porque ahora que fue la fiesta de septiembre, hubo que nos encontramos que apenas habíamos llegado a la casa y habían matado a un joven. Entonces ya por eso como que ellos se asustan, se trauman y ya no quieren participar en esto.
¿A qué seguridad más se refiere, señora Mari?
Pues yo a lo que me refiero en primer lugar es a vigilancia de la policía y a vigilancia de los mismos padres de familia que los dejan venir solos a tanto joven.
Muchísimas gracias, señora Mari. Obviamente todo lo que usted ha mencionado, muchos radioescuchas lo escucharán en su momento. Le agradecemos bastante que su tiempo y que haya querido estar y dar su opinión para 94.1. Gracias.
Another beautiful song by Lila Downs, La Bamba. Before that, we heard the voices from people who were celebrating at El Día de los Muertos celebration. And, you know, I think it's so important that we honor the ones, our loved ones who have passed on, especially you know, the young people whose lives have ended prematurely and tragically, and it was, you know, very impressive for me to hear the voices of those women who had lost their sons to violence in Oakland and who were there celebrating their lives. The title of the celebration this year, the Dia de los Muertos Festival, was Honoring the Past, Celebrating the Future, and I believe that really reflects a healthy relationship to life and death.
And one organization that's celebrating the future is Axis Dance Company. They're celebrating their 20th anniversary season, which opens tonight. Coming up next, Full Circle contributor Laura Haddon speaks with Judith Smith, the director of Axis Dance Company.
This is Laura Haddon for Full Circle on KPFA 94.1. I'm here today with Judith Smith, the artistic director and one of the founding members of Axis Dance Company. Axis Dance Company is an ensemble of dance performers with and without disabilities based in Oakland. So, Judith, how did you personally discover dance?
Well, it's in a very roundabout way. I actually grew up in Colorado and thought I was going to be riding jumping horses the rest of my life. And I was in a car accident when I was 17. And after about 5 winters in Colorado, I moved to Berkeley, which was a great thing to do, and met a woman right away and started doing some movement improvisation. And it was really kind of the first time that I'd been able to explore how I moved as a disabled person. And I got really interested in movement and ended up taking martial arts at a school called Hand to Hand in Oakland and met our founding artistic director, Thais Mazur, there. And she was a dancer who was interested in expanding her dance practice to include people with disabilities. And she got a group of us together to perform a piece in 1988, which we premiered in the Dance Brigade's Furious Feet Festival for Social Change. And so that's kind of how it started. It was not something I planned on at all.
So what sort of changes has the company gone through over the last, you've been around for 20 years now?
Yes. We're celebrating our 20th anniversary, which is a little surprising how quickly it creeps up on you. I think philosophically, early on, a lot of our early work was really directly about issues pertaining to disability. And we decided that we could actually say more about ability and more about dance if we didn't address those issues directly. Definitely, as people come and go from the company, because we all move so differently, you know, some of us use power chairs, some of us use manual chairs, some dancers have prosthetics, and then of course we have our incredibly talented non-disabled dancers, and the way we all move together and work together really changes when one or two people comes and goes.
And so where do you get your dancers from?
You know, dancers who come to us who don't have disabilities are often dancers who are looking for something outside the box of dance, something a little bit more unusual, something more experimental. And for our non-disabled dancers, early on we started teaching. People would tell us, you know, come up after we performed and ask us where they could go learn to do this. We had nowhere to send them. So we started teaching, and a wide range of people come to our classes, and many of our disabled dancers have come through our classes and our summer intensives. We spend about 50% of our time doing education work.
Is there a particular type of experience that your dancers have before they join the company, the dancers with disabilities?
Our disabled dancers, some of them have come to us having dance experience before becoming disabled, and then feeling like maybe there wasn't, you know, the possibility for them to dance, and then they found Axis or another company like Axis. But most of our dancers who are disabled come to us with very little experience. And as I did, you know, myself, it's been kind of on-the-job training. But, you know, the dancers that we choose are always people who have a really great sense of their body, have a good stage presence, tend to, you know, want to push themselves.
So what is the experience of collaborating across ability like?
Well, it's really exciting, and I think, you know, when we did our first piece, we didn't really have the intention to become a company, but we all got hooked because it was so innovative and so different and so outside of anything any of us had done. And I think that the exciting thing for Axis and companies like us, because there are, you know, several around the country and around the world, is that the potential for partnering work is radically expanded because of the different ways that we move, you know, and because we, our choreography necessarily incorporates, you know, the way wheelchairs move, the way people in wheelchairs move, the way a dancer might dance with prosthetics or with, you know, a different kind of prosthetic or without. So I think that's the exciting thing, is that it's kind of the creation and the innovation and the exploration just really never end. And what we're doing now, we weren't doing 20 years ago. You know, it's been, our movement vocabulary as a company has really evolved over the years. And I feel like, you know, still we're kind of at the tip of the iceberg.
Well, you're listening to Full Circle on KPFA 94.1. And for those of you just tuning in, I'm here with Judith Smith, artistic director and one of the founding members of Axis Dance Company. So, Judith, to what extent do the dancers actually have control over the choreography and the content of the performances?
Well, I think that really depends on the choreographers that we're working with. For the first 10 years, we did all of our choreography collaboratively from within the company. And in 1997, the company split up, and we made a really great decision to start commissioning choreographers from outside the company who had already established themselves and were extremely talented. And every choreographer that comes in works in the way that they would work with any other company. I think most of the choreographers that we work with tend to like to work collaboratively and glean a lot of the material from the dancers. And I think, you know, four choreographers coming in, most of them have not worked with a company like ours. So it's very new. And so they necessarily look to us to, you know, contribute material. That's fun for us too, because then we get to all bring our own personalities and our own styles into it. And I think what happens with the work is that it ends up being kind of a wonderful marriage of, you know, the choreographer's artistic point of view and our rather unique aesthetic.
And so what has the experience of working with Axis been like for you?
Oh, God. I mean, it's been so life-changing on so many levels. You know, it's opened a lot of doors. It's opened my eyes. I've been somebody who generally likes to do things that are a little bit outside the norm of what one would expect, especially of somebody who's disabled. And so for me, it's been a way to kind of channel all of the passion I had for horses and riding, which, you know, was, I mean, definitely it's just in my blood and still is, you know, into something that I felt was also really relevant and really important to society.
So do you consider the performances themselves explicitly political?
That's such a good question. And we've never set out to be a company that was there to make a political statement. But we did realize early on, like right away, that there's definitely a political and a social implication to what we're doing, because you don't see disabled people on stage very much, especially in dance. And you don't see people with and without disabilities collaborating as equals. And still to this day, and definitely 20 years ago, that was true. So I think what we do does definitely have a political implication. And, you know, what we really hope is that it just comes in, you know, people have to see us to believe what we do. I don't think it's something that, like ballet, that you can just say a word and people can conjure up an image. So I think what happens when people come and watch us is that they're really challenged in terms of how they look at dance and how they look at disability and ability. But I hope that they always go away with maybe a different sense of human potential and their own potential in general.
So you also go into classrooms, and you were saying that education is a huge part of your work.
Yeah.
So what is that work like? What is that experience like?
Well, we do probably perform 20 different assemblies at, you know, 15 to 16 schools a year. We bring students into our own theater in Oakland for performances. When we tour, very often we'll do a kids' performance. And it's, you know, we give the kids time at the end of our performances or our assemblies to ask questions. And it's kind of amazing because they will ask the kind of questions that their teachers and parents really wish they wouldn't ask, you know, especially of the disabled dancers. But they also ask some really great questions about dance and about how we work and why we do what we do. And I think the reason that we like working with kids, especially the younger ones, we do a lot of work with elementary schools, in-school residencies, classroom visits, etc., is that, you know, disability and dance, especially contemporary dance, are not something that are taught in schools very much. And so when we go in, we get to kind of educate about both. And we hope that we plant seeds in the kids' minds because, you know, there are kids in there that are going to want to be dancers, but they're probably going to be told they have the wrong body type to do ballet. And there are probably kids in there that are going to end up disabled. And, you know, we hope that we've given them an image of what is possible.
So you're listening to Full Circle on KPFA 94.1. I'm talking with Judith Smith, Artistic Director and one of the founding members of Axis Dance Company in Oakland. So Judith, tell me about your upcoming season.
Well, our upcoming season is November 14th through 16th at the Malanga Caspelord Center in downtown Oakland. It's our 20th anniversary season. So, you know, it's a big deal for us. We're really excited. We're going to be doing two world premieres, Sonia Delwade's fifth piece for us, A Room with No View. And then we're also premiering a piece called Vessel by Alex Ketley.
So since your company has been around for 20 years,
mm-hmm.
and you're such a huge part of the community, what do you want your audiences to walk away with?
Well, I really want our audiences to walk or roll away with a different sense of human potential and maybe of their own potential and a different view of what dance can be. And hopefully they'll just come and, you know, have a great time and really enjoy the work.
Well, thank you so much, Judith, for being with us today. Again, everyone, Axis Dance 20th Anniversary Show, November 14th through the 15th, also
16th.
The 16th as well.
Yeah.
And what's your website address?
It's axisdance.org, AXISDANCE.org, and people can find out about our other performances, upcoming classes, summer intensives, etc. And I hope people will come and check us out.
Great. Thanks so much, Judith.
Thank you.
And that brings us to the end of tonight's show. Tune in next week to Full Circle at the same time, Friday at 7 o'clock, and same station, KPFA 94.1 FM. Also, you can check out our archive shows on www.kpfa.org. Thanks to all the Raising Our Voices participants, Teresita Bautista, Erica Mazensky, Taizet Hernandez, Marti Dulales, Danielita Dulales, Dorothy Kidd, Evangelina Lara, RJ Losada, Zaya Butugs, Elma Bata, and Consuelo Sopelario.
And a special thanks to our production and technical interns, Nancy Andrade, Jill Montgomery, Sonia Taisi, Laura Bourbon, and Ali Budner. And from Group 33, Una Sangre, Golda, Laura, Gloria, Carl, Melody, and myself, Angela De Castro. Our executive producers are Ranjita G and Miss M. Our technical director is Frank Sterling.
Peace. If you have any questions or topics for future shows, give us a call at 510-848-6767, extension 627, or send an email to fullcircle@kpfa.org. With Laura holding down the controls, we've been your hosts, Imogene and Angela. Saying peace for now, and thanks for joining us tonight on Full Circle. Stay tuned for La Onda Bajita.
Hey, what's up, everyone? This is Free Will in Franklin, part of the Full Circle crew, and I just wanted to let everyone know that a band that played in our show a couple months ago, Hairdo, will be playing the Green Festival tomorrow, Saturday, 11:15 at 5 p.m. So go check out Hairdo. We'll go out with a little bit of Hairdo right now, so check out Hairdo tomorrow at the Green Festival at 5 p.m. Good night, you guys.
This is a listing of upcoming events in the Bay Area. The week, all events are wheelchair accessible. Please listen closely for contact numbers. On Friday, November 21st at 1 p.m., the Neo Deal Film Festival presents the Neo Deal, our hope for the future. This free event is located at 5714 Martin Luther King.